Hey everybody, how's it going? Today I would like to discuss what I find to be yet another encroachment on your ability to say that when you spend $20,000 or $40,000 or $60,000 on something, that you actually own it. And you know, this is one of those things where I just don't think we would have accepted it to the same extent in the past that we are now. You know, this is interesting when it comes to electric vehicles, because when it comes to electric vehicles, I see people accepting things when it comes to repair that or excuses that I would have never heard about with an internal combustion engine vehicle. Like, oh my God, the battery's high voltage. You can't just, you know, flip a switch and turn it off. You may kill yourself. And when you have a car that's literally has, you know, flammable fluid going through it. It's called gasoline. Or when it comes to laptops versus cell phones. I mean, if there was somebody out there that created an operating system where you were only allowed to install applications the manufacturer said you could install, we'd scream bloody murder. Or the idea that you can't change the bootloader on your computer to install your own operating system, we would be up in arms. Yet when it comes to cell phones, people constantly spend money on phones where you can't change the operating system, unlock the bootloader, or even install apps of your own choice if the manufacturer doesn't allow them onto their store. As paradigms shift, we are willing to give up freedoms that we accepted in the old paradigm that we just pretend to have no reason to exist in the new paradigm, even if we're using the devices for the same thing. And the newest encroachment on this appears to be with vehicles. Now, particularly the inability to sell the vehicle for a year or so after you purchase it. This is something that was announced with Ford with the Lightning F-150. It's going to come with a no-sale provision. Now, there are people that have tried to sell certain cars that they got from Ford early when they had signed this. So there was a wrestler, John Cena, who wound up getting sued, and he settled out of court for the Ford GT. You are not allowed to sell the Ford GT for 2 years, although admittedly, I imagine the Ford GT is slightly less popular than something like the F-150. The F-150 is a cultural icon in America. Every day I see people with a Ford F-150 where there is a good chance that they have never towed or hauled anything in their life. They use it as a single-user vehicle because America, it's a truck. It makes your dick bigger, and honestly, to some extent, they're just kind of cool. So I understand why people are likely going to be more up in arms over this than they are over this happening on the Ford GT. The F-150 is one of the best-selling vehicles in America. And this is the electric follow-up to it, so I understand why there is some aggravation here. If you spend $20,000 or $40,000 or $60,000 on something, I think that if you bought it, you kind of have the right to be able to say, I want to sell it. But at the same time, I understand the disdain for scalpers. They are one of the bottom feeders when it comes to capitalism, this idea that you're not adding any value to the transaction whatsoever. You do nothing but act as a middleman in an aggravating way. Again, you're not being a middleman that adds value by allowing me to file chargebacks where I otherwise would have to directly wire money to somebody to be able to buy a part. You're not teaching me anything. You're not providing me with a better experience. You're just going there and buying them all so that you could then sell them for $10,000 or $20,000 or $30,000 over the dealer price. And that's just kind of annoying. You know, like most people don't like when they're stuck relegated to dealing with scalpers. And you can tell this with what's been going on with GPUs for the past year. I imagine they're doing this because they don't want to deal with scalpers buying up everything and then people having a horrible experience going to a dealer that is out of stock and then having to pay $20,000 or $30,000 or $40,000 over MSRP. It's going to put a bad taste in people's mouths. That being said, how much of a bad taste is it going to put in people's mouths when they're not able to actually sell the vehicle? When you tell them, listen, I know that you spend $50,000 or $60,000 on this, but we get to say what you do with it. There really is that question as to whether or not you own something if the manufacturer gets to say what you do with it. With this computer, you know, many of the things are going to break inside this computer. And if the manufacturer said that, you know, if this chip that's very commonly dies in this device dies, this $2,000 or $1,000 computer is worthless, there really is an argument to be made there. Is this my computer or is it the manufacturer's? If the manufacturer goes out of their way to stop me from being able to do basic routine maintenance on my own product, and I am stuck going to them for that basic routine maintenance, is it really mine or is it yours? Because you seem to have a large say in what I do with what I own. And I think the same thing could be applied here when they say, you're not allowed to sell it for the first year. Many people are going to want to sell their car in the first year. Typically, in my experience, people either sell it once it's old or broken, or when it's new and they have serious buyer's remorse. So, and you're going to see a lot of that, particularly when it comes to an electric vehicle. It's one of the comments that was showing up a lot is I think they want to keep people from selling it if they dislike it. I don't really know if that's the case because I don't see how that particularly affects Ford, but A lot of people that do purchase an electric vehicle are going to realize that they made a mistake and go back to an internal combustion engine vehicle. It's something that you do need to get used to. I love electric vehicles. I use an electric vehicle. I love electric bikes. I build electric bikes. I find electric motors fun. I find electric vehicles fun. They're not for everybody. If you're in a cold climate, you're going to have to install a different outlet in your home, perhaps to be able to charge. Because if you're only putting out 12 amps at 110 volts, it's going to spend most of that power actually heating the battery and not much of that actually charging. You have to install a different outlet. If you are keeping it in an area where you don't have chargers available, you're kind of screwed. If you are traveling in a cold area and you think, I'm only traveling 100 miles, I have 140 miles of range, I'm good. Your battery is going to lose quite a bit because with lithium ion batteries, there is shrinkage in the winter. And also, admittedly, a lot of the times the gauge is actually lying to you. There's a lot that you got to get used to. Oh, and especially if you are using garbage like EVgo charge networks and you actually expect them to work. I have found more working payphones in New York City than I have EVgo chargers on a regular basis. And even if you report them, they don't bother addressing any of the issues 2 to 3 months later. One of the reasons that Tesla has become so popular is because their charging network, A, is everywhere, and B, it actually works. Again, with many EVgo chargers that I've had the ability to try, they're about as, they're kind of like payphones in New York City. You know, they're more useful as a urinal as they are for what they're actually designed for. I understand that people don't like scalpers, and I understand they want to see a better experience, but is this really going to help? How much of this is, a supply chain issue more than a scalper issue? And does this occur because of the long turnaround times as it is? Is the popularity of scalpers on your vehicles stemming from the fact that it is so difficult to buy one? Is it kind of like the tail wagging the dog thing? One of the reasons that they may be doing this is because they're recognizing that due to the supply chain issues, they don't have the ability to pump out enough of these vehicles to be able to get around scalping. You know, if you take a look at just the Mach-E, this was from last year. It says that they have a minimum 20-week wait. I decided to check again today with several different configurations. You could be waiting 22 to 26 weeks to get a Ford Mach-E. Over 22 weeks to purchase a car. And I think that they're learning from that experience. They don't have the ability to pump these vehicles out at a speed that is enough that they can saturate the scalpers. I'm not quite sure how much of this is a supply chain issue where they're really stuck and they really they need to be able to make exactly as enough vehicles for the people that really want to buy them versus maybe just scalpers are becoming much more popular in recent years. I have to say that as much as I have a disdain, a natural fundamental disdain for scalpers, I really am siding with the you shouldn't be able to tell me that I'm not even allowed to sell my own vehicle. You know, many people will shit on Tesla for a number of reasons, and it can be fun. Elon says a lot of stupid shit. He sets a lot of stupid timelines. But at the end of the day, it's really interesting that if you buy a Tesla, they do allow you to just sell it. Ford is actually limiting you with this new electric vehicle in a way that even Tesla's not limiting you. And I don't think that people should normalize it. I wouldn't purchase a vehicle if they said that I wasn't allowed to sell it. Again, what if something happens? What if you have a serious medical issue and now you are no longer able to work and you're only able to make a percentage of your salary on disability? What if you wind up having a serious financial problem? Well, you know, there's many reasons, legitimate, honest reasons, that you may want to sell a purchase that you make that is $40,000 to $60,000 within the first year. I would be insanely pissed if I figured out that I had a serious financial issue or some sort of unforeseen hardship and I was not able to sell my new vehicle to help me with that hardship because Ford said I couldn't. It doesn't seem like it's their business. I don't want to make it their business. I'm very curious to hear what you think. Let me know in the comments down below. Would you purchase a vehicle if they said you're not allowed to sell it within the first year? Or would you say F you? I personally think that they would make them say F you. And again, as I've said on this channel when it comes to electric vehicles, something that really, really aggravates me is how companies will attach all these limitations to electric vehicles. You cannot purchase the drivetrain. You cannot purchase this. You cannot purchase that. You cannot sell the vehicle in a year when this has nothing to do with an electric vehicle. The general public is going to associate all of these negative traits that are injected by the manufacturer with electric vehicles when they are inherently not traits of electric vehicles. I love electric motors. They're so much fun. I have some videos on my live channel taking apart a BBS HD, greasing it up, putting it back together, it working. They're fun. And I just, it just bothers me when these types of policies are then negatively associated with electric motors and by association electric vehicles because the manufacturer decides to do something like this. Is this the reality of the world that we live in nowadays? How many more products do you think that this will apply to given the supply chain issues and supply chain shortages that we have? Do you think we're going to, because think about it, if we're talking about this with cars, where you have many different companies making cars, what are we going to do with graphics chips where you have just, you know, again, you have NVIDIA and AMD, and that's pretty much it when it comes to the mainstream marketplace. What are we going to do with many different computer parts that are in short supply? What are we going to do with everything else? Is this something that's going to carry over? Because you see how anti-right to repair in one industry winds up applying to everything, whether we're talking about tractors, whether we're talking about laptops, cell phones, medical equipment, everything else. Is this going to be something that now applies to everything else, where if the manufacturer realizes that you did what you weren't supposed to do with their product, well, now they can sue you. I don't like it. I don't like it. And I could, you know, you could say that I am a little bit more open to the slippery slope argument than I should be, but I think I should be. I think you should be too. Anyway, that's about it. I'll end my ramble, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye now.